incomprehensible. Literally, it was, what are they doing? And it took a steady amount of listens to kind of see the method to the madness.
The first time I heard Calculating Infinity, I was like, what the fuck is this? Turn it off. This is just noise.
It's like I need to study to understand a lot of their music, and it's fantastic.
Like one of those old TVs with the dial, and just rolling through the dial and having a bit of a cartoon and a bit of this, and just the way it rapidly changed so many genres of music just in one song.
Completely unique. No, there's been no band before them, no band since them. You know, the way they combine angular math rock with jazz and you name it, there's everything in that band.
Much like Metallica's Kill 'Em All, they took everything that they grew up on and just played it like they were on crack.
Something really different, really unique, really, really unusual, but still super heavy. I remember when I got that first record, it's like, wow, what is this exactly?
They were creating such dense music that you kind of had to listen to it a few times to really grasp what was going on.
I remember when this album came out, there was absolutely nothing like it. You know, it was just pure fucking chaos, and it created an immediate reaction with people. You either loved it or you hated it, but there was really nothing at all lukewarm about it. And to have that kind of reaction with people is pure genius.
Calculating was assembled in a really weird way in different parts. So for me, I was fed this record piecemeal for a little while, and it didn't click. When I eventually did, that's when it all made sense.
I think one of the reasons why our music sounded so complex to people and so crazy was that because we didn't have to write records in the beginning. We were just like, let's just write a song and put everything we got into it. Let's not say, oh, we need to save parts for this next song or whatever. We'd be like, we're writing three songs, you know, and that's it. We basically said, let's just write three EPs and put it together. And like, that's what we're like, we're good at EPs. Like, let's just not even think about like this big body of work. Let's just put everything we have into every song as if we don't really have to write a record worth of songs. And that's what we did.
It's just one of those things that was so monstrous, it like changed the climate of the whole scene for a while. You know, and I think Dillinger kind of ushered in a phenomenon of their own with that record.
With 43% Burnt specifically, I feel like that riff is one of the great iconic metal riffs.
Our goal was always to combine our influences in a way that created something that sounded new. It was the mid-90s, really, 1997. It would have been very easy at that time to say, let's make a new metal type band and try to make it big.
It was at a time where everybody was looking to make things, you know, cleaner and more accessible and easier to digest. And you know, here comes these kids from New Jersey who just blow the fucking door wide open and pioneered a change in this thing called math metal forever.
Mathcore as a thing existed before Dillinger. For whatever reason, Dillinger is the band that just kind of like, you know, nailed it.
There's something really special about a band that's able to present an uncompromising artistic vision and still reach an audience and still be able to communicate with one.
It's this great snapshot of that band at that moment, obviously, as all records are. But, you know, it would never, ever, ever be the same after that.
It's exceptional. It's over the top. If you want something that's going to test your own limits of audible understanding, it's Dillinger.
I remember the day that I brought Sugar Coated Sour demo into Adam in Kessler Rehab. He was trying to, you know, recover from this horrible injury, which left him paralyzed. And I remember being like, should I play this for him? Is he gonna bum him out, you know? And I played it for him, the song Sugar Coated Sour, which was the first song off the record, and he's like, he starts smiling, he's like, this is gonna be awesome.
I can't even say how many times I've seen Dillinger since 97, 98. Since day one, they were always a band that jumped in 2 feet first, kicked you in the teeth, spat in your face, over the top. And that's never gone away.
I broke a guitar on stage not knowing how I was gonna get another one. Like, not having money, investing everything into doing this without any expectation of making money at it or having it be a career. That's the most exciting, I think, time in any musician's life.
We never tried to like intentionally not play after them, but when we had to, we were like, oh man, we gotta go on after Dillinger, that sucks. Tough act to follow.
the best live band of their generation. Their shows are always fucking insane.
Incredible. Absolutely insane.
Still the best concert I've ever seen was them. Their music was confrontational. It was like for the throat. And you could tell that if you went to see him live that they were going to fuck you up. And that's exactly what they did.
Ben is an incredible performer. He's just, there's not many guys that put that much energy into performing every single night on tour for the past how many years. This dude is getting up on stage and what, destroying his body?
I've never known a band more loyal to killing themselves on stage to produce the wildest show that you could imagine, or in the studio pushing boundaries to places we've never knew existed.
I think Ben Weinman's a genius. Obviously, just listening to that record and everything that's come afterwards. I don't think you'll ever, hear another band like Dillinger again.